2016 has been a banner year for Hawaii. We've hosted two international events. In June, there was the Coral Symposium, and in September, the IUCN conference. Hawaii is uniquely positioned in the middle of the Pacific. It's a wonderful opportunity for us to learn tonight and throughout the course of the Distinguished Lecture Series about the wonderful discoveries and exploration that's going on in our waters around Hawaii. At this time, I'd like to recognize a couple of my fellow board members who have been instrumental in the Distinguished Lecture Series. First, Timothy Gard. Tim Gard has been was the originator of the idea for the Distinguished Lecture Series. And Tim, are you? Can you stand and be recognized, please? Tim Gard, ladies and gentlemen. Mahalo, Tim. About 3.5 years ago, Tim came up with the idea, and it's just been a terrific success. I'd also like to recognize and give my appreciation to Nancy Taylor. Nancy, would you please be recognized? Nancy has been just a wonderful driving force, and her energy and enthusiasm has been terrific. Without her, I don't think a lot of these events would be going forward. And keeping the momentum going forward is important for the Distinguished Lecture Series. I think we're fortunate in Hawaii that we have the University of Hawaii and other institutions, brother and sister institutions of the Waikiki Aquarium, such as, for example, the Bishop Museum, who have been producing and nurturing and employing such creative and brilliant scientists who have agreed to be presenters tonight. No Distinguished Lecture Series would be possible without, of course, our distinguished lecturers. And I can't imagine anyone better to present tonight's speaker than a former distinguished lecturer, Dr. Richard Pyle, who gave a terrific presentation last year. So Dr. Richard Pyle will be presenting our speaker tonight. Thank you very much, and enjoy the presentation this evening, folks.
Thank you. Thank you, and thank you all for coming tonight. This is a great turnout. I was a little shocked to find that the normal path I walked down to the chapel was blocked off and had to circumnavigate a little bit to get here, so I appreciate your perseverance in getting here. So I've known Sonia for about 7 years now. When she first came to Hawaii to meet with Dr. Les Watling at the University of Hawaii to discuss her ideas for her PhD research. But I've actually known her father quite a bit longer. Her father, Mike Rowley, in the UK, is a legend in the history of what we now call technical diving, you know, using advanced diving techniques, rebreathers and mixed gas and whatnot. And so it was kind of an honor to meet Mike's daughter when she came here to Hawaii. At the time, I assumed, you know, I thought of myself as being this sort of guru master of deep mixed gas diving and, you know, playing the role of mentor and all of that. But it didn't take long for me to come to realize that our roles quickly reversed. Sonia, you know, I began mixed gas diving in the late 1980s, and I was in my 20s at the time, and I thought of myself as sort of a pioneer. But it turned out Sonia started doing trimix diving when she was 14 years old, 2 years before I started doing it. And the reason is she grew up on a liveaboard boat. Her parents owned a liveaboard dive boat and used to take people diving all the time in the UK, which is some pretty rigorous diving conditions compared to what we're used to out here in the Pacific. So Sonia essentially grew up around diving since she was a very young child. And that has shown in her skills as a diver. You know, over time, I finally had to concede she was, well, a much better diver than I was. But at least I was a good scientist. But it didn't take too long to figure out that she was a far, far better scientist than I am. And some of the research she's going to talk to you about tonight is actually amazingly cutting edge. Manipulative experiments down 400 or 500 feet deep is just utterly unheard of. And I'd always imagined someday, you know, 10, 20 years in the future, we'd be at the stage of doing that. And, you know, she doesn't have a lot of patience, so she said, well, let's just do it now. And that's sort of the attitude that I've come to know of Sonia and her work. So I'm very honored and pleased to introduce my colleague, my dive buddy, my friend, and my hero, Dr. Sonia Rowley.
Okay, am I working? Oh yeah, woohoo. All right, well, I can hardly wait to hear what I'm going to say. Thank you very much, Richard. Thank you very much, Chris. And thank you very much for coming to listen to my accent this evening, for want of a better way of putting it. So as you can tell, I'm not indigenous. But I am very, very delighted that Hawaii has had a historical connection with the British. Probably didn't start off so great, but certainly has ended up and continues to be that way. So what you see here is one of my favorite sea fans. I mainly study sea fan corals, or commonly known as gorgonians. This is called Anela. And I was delighted to hear that Anela actually means angel in Hawaii. A very good friend of mine is in the audience this evening, also called Anela, and she certainly epitomizes that the meaning. So I'm going to discuss a little bit to you about the ones that I find and what they do and what I'm trying to find out. Now, some of you have probably seen this slide before. I have totally stolen some of Richard's slides, shamelessly. And I want to describe to you what the Twilight Zone is, okay? It's very mysterious. And so most of the time, people have done research on scuba. And this is down to about 50 meters, which is about, I don't know, 160 feet or something. I'm still metric. And so that's where a lot of the research has actually happened. And so we're very familiar with it. Out of sight, out of mind, everybody associates corals with the hard corals, and rightly so. Now, if we wanted to go deeper, then we'd have a submarine, okay? And that would go, you know, really below 150 meters, because really these things are actually extremely expensive. They can be up to like $40,000 a day just for a dive. And it's a tremendous experience, but it's not something that you can just whip off to the bank and get yourself a sub dive. Not me, anyway. And so, and the other thing is it's quite limited, seeing through the porthole. So there's this section in the middle here that nobody really seems to know very much about. And this is what we go and research and dive and discover and explore. And the reason why I've got burr there is because it gets really cold, I can assure you. And I have buddies that wear board shorts and shirts. I do not. I feel the cold. The Twilight Zone or Twilight Reefs, it's been officially called the mesophotic coral ecosystem, which trips off the tongue very, very well, as you can imagine. However, we prefer to call them Twilight Zone or Twilight Reefs. It's very mysterious and actually depicts what you're experiencing when you're down there. And Twilight itself actually came about back in 1972 on a National Geographic article written by Stark and Stark. And he just basically said at the end, you know, these mysteries of the Twilight Reef. And people like Richard and so on have been stealing that phrase ever since, which is just fantastic. It's really, really, very interesting. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about those. And here we've got one of our colleagues, Brian Green, catching, I think, Tosinoides, but not the Obama. This would be in Pakeen Atoll in Micronesia. And the main parameters that are very, very different when you go into the Twilight Zone, you're having a reduced light. The water flow is a serious consideration. You've got all these different flows happening. You've got things coming up, flow going down, things going across. There's temperature differentiation, and also water chemistry. So these are going to affect the animals in which you actually see that are going to be in the Twilight Zone. Now, for quite a while now, people associate the Twilight Zone with these wonderful leptoseries reefs, which is off Maui, and this was taken by Hearl, and this is about 67 meters. And they really are spectacular. You get these mono-specific reefs. And there's patches of little spots of those around the Indo-Pacific. But actually, what you really find for the majority of the Twilight Zone around the Indo-Pacific is this. And these are the gorgonian corals that I'm telling you about. And they are very, very abundant and diverse. And you get forests of them. And they supply a nursery and a resource in order for other fishes to live and lots of other creatures. Now, just to put things into perspective, so why do we get so many gorgonians? Why so many? So first things, I just wanted to introduce you to actually what is the level of diversity of corals, per se, on the planet. So here you can see octocorals, of which gorgonians are a group within, consist of the large majority of coral species on this planet. Then you're starting to look at the scleractinians, which are the hard corals of what we're so familiar with. So that lends question that you've got a tremendous amount of biodiversity for the octocorals. How come? Then you've got things like the hydrocorals, the stylastrids, and the antipatharians, the black corals that you see quite often on the reefs here. So ongoing research is basically showing us that the octocorals, the octocorallia, were actually around before Precambrian time. So we were over 750 million years ago. And in some, depending on what you, analysis you use, whether it's molecular or corroborating it with the fossil record, it can be over 800 million years. So that's quite, you know, that's quite old. That's really old. And then the recent common ancestors are 400 million years old. Where you compare that with the scleractinia, and they are much younger. And that doesn't make them any less, but it does mean that the octocorals have been around a lot longer in order to diverse and actually become more biologically successful, perhaps. And one of the things that I find extremely interesting is how. How are they so biologically successful over geological time? So what's a gorgonian? Let's just be specific. Octocorals, basically you have tentacles and pinnate tentacles, where that arrow is right here, and there's in eight. Very simple. And so your scleractinia is six tentacles or multiples of six. It's very simple. Keep it nice and simple. Eight for the octocorals, six for the hexacorallina. They're very diverse, and they have friends. They have very, very popular friends. Little pygmy seahorse here. And here's one that, can anyone see it in there? Quite. This is a new species that we discovered a couple of years ago on Ponape. And if memory serves, we're dealing with something over nearly 100 meters deep. So that's the sort of thing that we find. Every time we go diving, we find something new. It's fantastic. And it's tiny as well, so it blows my mind. Now, there's many ways to be a gorgonian. I find them extremely beautiful, which is rather fortunate because I like to study them. And you see, they do all sorts of various interesting shapes and sizes. However, there are exceptions to the rule. And there's barium. And I must say, I'm that shallow, I was just totally in denial that this was a gorgonian, and I just had to refuse it for a long time, and I had to go back and do a lot of my shallow water ecology again because I wouldn't include it. So that goes to show you what sort of person I am. Anyway, so this is a gorgonian, and that's based on the actual tissue structure. And some gorgonians are interesting sizes and shapes, and people name them after them. And yes, I am not joking. And so this is what the deep sea spawns. And then you have these really exciting ones. Notice those claws. And so Wolverine eye. And I'm sure every lady in the building is noticing the man's claw. Okay. And I wanted to introduce you to Paracalyptophora, which is the first deep-sea gorgonian I ever saw. I was very, very fortunate as a consequence of working with Professor Les Watling, who's in the audience tonight. Thank you very much. He flew in today, so I'm very impressed that you're here. And he invited me to go on this deep-sea sub-trip to the northwestern Hawaiian Islands, and oh my God, I was pumped. I could not believe it. And I couldn't believe some of the things I was seeing as well. I was like, my goodness. So look at this. This is a polyp. I mean, I was like, what is it doing looking like this? I mean, what is going on? I remember the first, I took a picture of it under the microscope. I sent him an email. I was like, what is this? This is fantastic. So these things keep me up at night. I want to know why they look like this. What is that? Why have you evolved to be this way? And you'll notice the little sort of calcareous stuff. They're called sclerites. And there's tons of them, huge level of diversity. And we use them as one of the tools in order to actually identify them. And in the Twilight Zone, these are the new species that I'm actually finding. Every time I go down, as I say, I find something new. And it's typically in the plural. And it blows my mind, and I could just go on for ages. So those of you who have seen Richard talk, you'll all see that he has a similar slide with all sorts of fishes. Well, it's exactly the same for the gorgonians. And it blows my mind, and it keeps me off the streets. So it's just very, very good. Very good. And so through the exploration that has happened over the past 20 plus years that I've now joined the team, they've been to lots and lots of places across the Indo-Pacific. And there's still more places to go. Of course, we usually, you know, travel and research on a shoestring, so it's really quite fun. But one of the patterns that that they've noticed with the fish, and I'm also noticing with the gorgonians, is in the twilight zone, at the depths that we actually go to, even across the Pacific, so west to east, we still have the same level of diversity. We might have different species, but we still have the same number of different species. But in the shallow water, as you go across the Pacific, away from the continents here, and towards Easter Island, you actually have a reduction in species numbers. And that would make sense. You've got this stepping stone situation. There's less landmass. But why would the deeper ones still maintain their biodiversity? So we're looking into various aspects of why this may be. Because when you go down past like 130 meters, this is beyond where sea level change has impacted. So sea level cycles, they tend to go around 130 meters over the millennia, you know, just up and down, up and down, up and down. And so if you're a gorgonian or a, you know, well, a gorgonian more so, fish, they can move around, they cheat. But gorgonians, you know, they can stay pretty deep and not be affected by all this movement. And so that's one of the things we're thinking, but I'll waffle on for ages, and I must press on. But I wanted to introduce you to some of the research that we've been doing at a place called Pakin Atoll, Ant Atoll, and Ponape in the Federated States of Micronesia. And this is just to give you an example and as a case study of some of the research that we've been doing. And here's our team. We're very prolific. There's lots of us, as you can see. They dress for the environment. Everybody always goes on about it, so I may as well do that as well. There's Richard there, myself, and Brian Green, who's on the Big Island. And we're test pilots for Poseidon and Cislunar technology. And we pack up our stuff, and we go, and we discover new species to science and set up experiments. And we're pretty low-key, actually. It's become very much a very pizzazz thing to do. And so, and this is Packy, and I wanted to share with you. As you can tell, it's terrible researching here. Terrible. Really bad. Don't want to do it. Mm-mm. So we go there every year, and it's just magical. The people are wonderful. There's no electricity. It's just, oh, my God, everything. You'll totally have your fill of coconut. And it's just really divine. But I wanted to sort of, one of the questions that people say quite a lot is, what is it like when you dive down deep? What do you experience? So I wanted to try and encapsulate how that feels. And let's see if we...
What's my purpose in life? What do I mean by who am I? Okay, calm down, get a grip now. Ooh, this is an interesting sensation. What is it? It's a sort of a tingling in my... Well, I suppose I better start finding names for things. Let's call it, tail. Yeah, tail. And hey, what's this roaring sound? Whooshing past what I'm suddenly going to call my head. Wind. Is that a good name? It'll do. Yay, this is really exciting. I'm dizzy with anticipation. Or is it the wind? There's an awful lot of that now, isn't there? And what's this thing coming towards me very fast? So big and flat and round, it needs a big wide-sounding name like ow, ound, round, ground. That's it, ground. I wonder if it'll be friends with me. Hello, ground.
Okay, don't think. Nobody think. No ideas, no theories, no nothing.
That was Richard. I probably didn't explain it too well. We get thermoclines down there, and I tell you, when packing was the worst, you're going from like 30 to 28, 30 degrees centigrade, and all of a sudden, you're met with like 12 to 13, you know, and it's like, boom, and you're like, oh my God. But, you know, you're like, why would you go down there? Because you're seeing new species just there. And literally you can see this like shimmering water just like that. And you're like, you know what? I've got to do it. But it is ice cream head or brain freeze or whatever you guys call over here. We call them ice cream head. And you're just like, so, you know, this is how it feels. You know, this is, you know, it's not all like pizzazz, you know. Anyway, we try and make it as sexy as possible. Now, I wanted to, so Anella is really important to me, okay, as a person and also as a coral. Now, Anella here, pictured, looking very beautiful, very pink, we like pink. And it can be found across most of the Indo-Pacific, but it also can be found from shallow, like 5 meters of waters, all the way down to like 300. And of course, if you've got these thermoclines, and how does it do that? Like, what is that? Have we got, you know, records correct? What's going on? So I decided to conduct some experiments to see its temperature tolerance. Now, the first time I did this, I noticed that I mapped out the thermoclines. I thought, right, we're on it. This is good. We're going to know what we're doing. We're going to find out where they are. And I'm going to do a transplant experiment. So I got all the guys all geared up. So we did this last year. And so this was my experimental design. So all you budding scientists out here, it's always good to have your experimental design and know your statistics before you start. Okay, just take that nugget home with you if you take nothing home from today. Now, so I decided to get some colonies, multiple colonies, replication is good, and put them at different depths. So here you've got 30 meters, the source colonies are at 90 meters, and then down to 130 or more. And those are the different distinct temperatures that we were experiencing. So I thought, well, we're good. And then I was going to do all these analysis and bring it home, and it was going to be great. So I wanted to, this is the process of it. This is Rich and Brian. We're testing out the site. We're sorting it out. We're going to see if this has actually got enough anellas and other species. And as you can see, we're good for numbers of coral. This is a great place. In fact, this is what it pretty much all looks like down there. It's fantastic. There's me coming up to sample the coral. And so we can actually start transplanting it. There's Brian, he's tagging it for me, and every single coral we have is, I take a scaled image so we can go back to it every year. So all bases are covered. Then on our decompression at 30 meters, we actually get these little clippings of coral and we make blocks out of them. Okay, so we're not idle, we keep working, we don't swan around and do nothing. On our decompression, which is very considerable, we make things. And then on the next dive, we go down and we get this block and we transport it to the depth that we want it to test survivorship. We want to test how it's so temperature tolerant over time. Maybe this could give us some clues on its biological success. And so here it is, it's perpendicular to the flow. And I left these for a year. I thought, right, let's see what happens. I've done transplant experiments before in the temperate and tropical regions, we're good. So what did happen? Over the course of last year, we had some very interesting temperature anomalies. And as you can see, these were the shallow water ones, which were heavily overgrown by invasive algae. This algae was a band around the island of Pohnpei from 25 meters down to 60 meters, and it was quite a shock. We were like, good Lord, what have we got here? I remember I presented this at Harvey Mudd a couple of weeks ago, and there were some girls at the front at the university there, and I thought they were going to cry. And I was like, well, that's okay. This is information. It's telling me stuff, because they're not all dead. Now, but it was a concern. It was an enormous concern. And we were able to sort of traffic light this, what we were finding, to the local communities, which found it very interesting. And but the good thing about it is that I actually discovered that the protocol still worked. So shortly you'll see that my actual controls really did work. So the controls are at 90 meters, and here they are, and they're live and kicking. Everything was fine. So I knew that the actual method, the design, was good. But the environment was not good. The corals could not handle it. When I went down to the deep ones, they were all dead. And I was like, goodness gracious me, what have we got here? So we took a suite of environmental parameters, and one of them was very, very telling. And that was, when it comes up, temperature. So this is temperature at different depths, every 10 meters, down to 150 meters from the surface. And what we saw over a year. So what we saw was very interesting. The first thing, at March, there was a curious temperature anomaly, and it just flatlined, and it went very, very hot, and they had a weird tide, and it just, you know, loads of stuff died. And the communities were very, very concerned. And this is when the algal bloom started. But then we also noticed that the actual temperature differentiation within a day was very, very strong. I think that was at its maximum. We were like, my goodness, this is unbelievable. These corals are subject to a huge temperature range on a daily basis, sometimes within half an hour to an hour. So this is what it looked like over like just a week. This huge temperature, up and down, up and down, up and down. So of course, when we go diving, we just and we meet these thermoclines. Basically, we're just meeting at one point at one time when the temperature loggers showed us that this was happening all the time over a huge, vast range. I was like, oh my goodness, actually, this is really interesting. So all was not lost. I decided, well, first of all, we give all our data to the local communities. They can see it. They can see how they can make conservation management decisions based on a lot of different things. But also that it was quite strong and to do with climate change. But I thought, what are we going to do with these anellas? And I thought, well, no, we can just test survivorship. You know, how is it going to survive? What happens if I've got all these algal-covered ones, and then I just pop them down back to their original depth? So basically, I put a whole load up there. I let them all get terribly infected with algae, and we put them down just before we left back to 90 meters to see if they're going to survive. Are they going to be stronger, or are they going to die? So that's some of the experiments that we're actually doing, and we're testing it using all sorts of different molecular and morphological techniques. So watch this space. Also, as I said, the temperature and the environmental data is actually really important to the local community. So this is Sonny Rek Pakin, which is the chief of Pakin Atoll. And here I am playing Count the Starfish, and I believe Julie, who took this photograph, is in the audience this evening. It's completely bizarre. I met her on Ponape in Pakin and saw her in Starbucks yesterday. I was like, hey, I'm going to use your photo tomorrow. So thank you. Great photo. And so what happens is these guys have, all we do, I mean, it was one of those things that you hope that your work would be useful to a local community, but I just never push it, you know, because if your expectations, disappointment. These people have come to us and asked us if we will help them make conservation management decisions at the governmental level in their community. And that was, it blew me away. I think the other reason is sometimes I run out of ethanol to actually preserve my specimens, so I have to use rum. And I think that's the only reason why they hang around with me. Oh, these guys are like, what are you just... Anyway, so you get a lot of information out of them if you do that. So back to this geological stuff, you know. This is some of the geomorphology that we actually see down there. Apart from the one at the top there, that was actually taken by Chip Fletcher, and that's in Kaneohe Bay. And I'm hoping that we're going to find something quite so distinct, actually, at other areas around the Indo-Pacific. But these are the other things that we can look at, start looking at the geomorphology, start looking at these different patterns, and seeing how climate change and all the rest of it, how the reefs have responded over time, and how this has affected the biology that we see today. And so one of the things I wanted to do was actually, Steve, this is from Steve, my current postdoc advisor, I didn't put the acknowledgements on there somewhere, and so pioneering work on how the different seas, over the millennia, you've got different ocean chemistry. So sometimes you've got high magnesium calcite seas, and sometimes you've got low magnesium calcite seas. And this is really important for carbonate organisms. Now, gorgonians are some of those organisms. And my big idea was to copy, to some degree, what had been happening, what had, research that had been done on other calcareous animals, to see how they responded and see if that was relative to how they've evolved over time. Now, the important thing is with gorgonians is there's three different key ways to be a gorgonian. So these are axis cross-sections. And so the scleractinia on the side, they have one particular way in order to make up their axis. Then you've got the holaxonia, which is very much very protonaceous with some calcium carbonate. And then you've got the calcaxonia, which is very much carbonate dominated. And so There's some of us that are actually thinking that the way that the oceans have changed over time has changed, has actually influenced how they've diverged and actually their the biodiversity and how they are so biologically successful. So I thought, that's great. I'm going to set up some experiments. It's going to be super easy. We're going to keep these things. We're going to put them in all these different waters, and we're going to test them, and it's going to be awesome. And this is my project design. I was going to have all these little particular species of corals, and I was going to put them in all these different replicates. And that's what got me in touch with Waikiki Aquarium. I actually said to Andy Rossiter after Randy Kasaki's talk, I was like, oh, I want to keep some azeanthellae gorgonians. He's like, well, come on down. So we made this. This is my aquaria. It's very good. This is the field aquaria. It's high tech. And I got all these gorgonians and took them back to Waikiki Aquarium. And here I am just placing them in there now. And so Waikiki Aquarium, I want to give a special thanks to Gwen Lentes, Erin Kelly, and Jonathan Casey. I don't know if they're here this evening, but they are the bomb. They are absolutely brilliant. They set up this fantastic system. And we populated them with gorgonians, and we're trialing the system out. But what we didn't realize is actually they're extremely difficult to keep. They are impossible to keep. They're really hard. You go around, and I've been talking at Aquarius conferences and stuff like that, and loads of people are just scratching their heads. They're very difficult. And what we discovered is I've been doing these feeding experiments. And so you can see here, this is an astrogorgia here. I've been just really, really focusing, filming them a great deal, and seeing what they eat. Now, as you can see, they're kind of moving around a little bit here and stuff like that. But actually, the reality of it is they seem to move around and have curious behavior, but not actually catching anything. They move and twitch and all this stuff. Trust me, I've been staring at hours and hours and hours of footage. And it makes no sense to me why they're moving. And most people feed them like artemia and things like that. And what I discovered through just filming them closely over a period of time is they actually spit out the artemia, and they don't actually eat these things. And so what happened with this is, if I can just move this on a little bit, is we have Karyojoa. So most people know Karyojoa, the snowflake coral here in Hawaii, and it's supposed to be invasive, so we decided we'd do some experiments, and we fed them artemia and other large feeds over a period of 6 weeks. Now, there was no shortage of food going into these tanks, but they starved to death. So, gorgonians don't eat what people think they eat. In fact, people aren't really sure. We think that they are, I think they're gardening bacteria. And also absorbing particulate and dissolved organic matter. And so that's what we're working towards right now. So I just wanted to give you a little taster of some of the research that's going on, the collaborations between Waikiki Aquarium, the University of Hawaii, Bishop Museum, and our Association for Marine Exploration, which means we can dive. And here's some of the things I'm testing also is I'm doing the transcriptomics of the microbes and also the host to see if we've got metabolic pathways that are actually reciprocal. So are they working together? How are they actually being so biologically successful over time? Because their polyps obviously don't eat big things. They're getting what's coming from the outside environment. I wanted to share with you this video. What you saw there, we're not quite finished yet, we're doing really well for time. I want to extend my thanks to many, many people here. But I just wanted to qualify what we just saw on that video. And that was all footage taken this year. The first half was our expedition to Pohnpei, Pakin, and Ant Atoll. And pretty much the vast majority of the creatures that you saw there were new to science. And it's always a privilege. And then after that was a very recent trip, which you may have seen in the press, funded by Conservation International. And one of the people here, Caleb, was on one of the subs. And we were able to go down to the Geology seamounts and Luihi, which is just off the Big Island, so we're keeping it local. And again, finding new species to science. And just seeing actually what's like down there, because one of the seamounts that we went to see, no one has ever been down before. So again, we're seeing new things, always new things. Hawaii has a wealth of biodiversity, and it's very, very unique, but also connected in many, many ways to the rest of the Indo-Pacific. And so a lot of the research that we do, without going into a tremendous amount of detail, because you'll slip off into a small coma, is related to that connectivity and that community relatedness as well. And the shark as well, you'll find a lot of those videos actually online. It really was a tremendous experience. So for me, it's not just about diving deep, although admittedly it is where I am most happiest, which is hardly surprising given my lineage. But we find so many answers to how various creatures are biologically successful over time. And I think in this day and age, it's extremely important. And I wanted to just share with you just a few things before we close, because it often comes up in questions. Do we see the impact of humans, anthropogenic impact, on these deeper reefs? Well, yes, we do. And mostly on the continental regions, obviously, because on the continents and things like that, I think they're just a little bit more spoiled for fear of sounding somewhat more judgmental. You've got more resources. And when I did my PhD, I did it in Indonesia, and it was fantastic. And when I sort of highlighted to some of the indigenous population, I was like, look, you know, the reefs are not doing so well. And they were like, that's okay, the government will give us some more money, and we'll just dive, we'll just go and fish deeper. And which is fair enough, but it's not the solution. And what I found on the oceanic islands and atolls, they have evolved a different mindset. They need to have foresight. They need to know where their next meal is coming from. And so that's extremely important. So I've noticed that the way that they actually keep their marine resources is really impressive, actually, very impressive. I've seen some of the most beautiful reefs on the planet, and you've seen some of that this evening, so all is not lost. Nature will certainly outlive us. But here is some of the stuff that I've seen at the Philippines, mainly, is you get fishing line and you get snagging and things like that. And you can see the chaps here, Brian and Richard, are trying to find a fish amidst lots of salt, silt. So I didn't really see them at the end of that. That was at the beginning. So we do see that active impact. So you really have to sort of go a bit further out so we don't have to deal with that. But that's quite, I mean, it's an issue when you've got all the diving equipment that we have. The other thing is people want to know how I collect. And so very simple, every gorgonian that I see, I've got usually environmental data attached to me. Rich and Brian tend to call me a little data station. So I've got everything time synced. So every gorgonian I find, I take a photograph of it, and I know exactly what that gorgonian, what depth it was, and all the rest of it at any one time. So I take a photo of it. I take a photo of what I call my paddle, so I have all that information with me. And it keeps me on my system as well, so I know what my rebreather's doing, so I'm always knowing what it's doing. And then I snip a little bit off, and I pop it in a bag, and you can see there's my lighting system there. I call it my antenna. I like to be as hands-free as possible. As Rich said, I'm a little bit impatient. I don't want to have to start juggling stuff down there. And I keep collecting, so while the fish boys are hanging out, I keep collecting gorgonians because this is information. This is telling me what's going on. This is helping me to see how things have changed across bathymetry, across these environmental parameters, and hopefully over time. As I say, this is where the work is. This is where you spend the next 6 to 8 hours of your life processing the specimens and then preserving them in rum to people keep me very, very well supplied with my alcohol problems, so, you know, it's all good. And this is what Rich was referring to. Again, it's a question. I don't usually like to sort of do this, but people do ask. I was raised largely on this vessel as a child, as a teenager. That's my mum, and my bedroom was a wheelhouse, and I was actually diving. This is a 67-foot MFE motor fishing vessel, 96 tons. She was built in 1946 by Macduff in northeast Scotland, and she was beautiful. And that was my first dive when I was 11, and then there was me, I was about 4 or 5 or something ridiculous. So I think that covers all the usual questions that people then tend to ask. Why would you want to do that kind of stuff? And I swear to God, I just had sweatpants on there, and it was Scotland. I would not do that now. I would not do that now. Absolutely not. But when you're a kid, you really don't care. You really don't care. And so I am tremendously fortunate. And it has indeed been my pleasure to share that with you this evening. I do believe that we can't keep what we have without sharing it. And it seems to be the most powerful way to deliver a message. So with that, I'll thank you for your attention and be happy to take any questions. Yes.
There was an article, I believe in the Washington Post today, about massive coral bleaching on the Barrier Reef. What significant threats to the biodiversity of coral exist that may or may not be found in shallow water?
What the significance, as in like an act of refugium? Is that a refugium? Right, okay, so basically from the, thank you, from the recent, and it's been going on for a short while now, recently now, is the mass bleaching that's happening on the Great Barrier Reef. And what sort of implication does the deeper reefs, the Twilight Zone, have for helping to sort of supplement this kind of damage? Well, first things first, some corals, as you heard from the last speaker here, Dr. Ruth Gates, is there's some what I call coral with balls, and they do very, very well. But obviously, a lot of them are not. Many, many species that you'll find actually down deeper are not the same, and so they have a different tolerance. It seems to me that the overwhelming kind of hypothesis of refugia is not fully supported. So I'm not 100% sure, because there's not enough evidence to say it. It's still an ongoing concern, I think. It would be great if it did. And I think in some species and in some cases it will. But I don't think the majority will. Yes?
So related to coral bleaching, I mean, coral bleaching is when the photosynthetic algae is released from the coral.
Yes. Some species, yes, but mostly no. I actually did my PhD thesis on a zooxanthellate gorgonian in Indonesia, but they don't usually go too deep. In the oceanic islands and atolls, because you've got clearer water, you can get the brariums and all the rest, a couple of species that go down to about 70 or 80 meters, but then they're not looking very happy. Yeah. You know what I mean? So they're largely a zooxanthellate, yes. So they won't be overwhelming the reefs. Yes?
On a typical dive, what is your max operating depth and water time?
Right, okay, well that depends on what we're doing. If we were, I think one of the deepest is either 154 or 157 meters or something off the top of my head. And we're not down there for very long, so that would be anything between a 6 and 8 hour dive. The maximum bottom time, I mean, quite most of the time we do like between 90 and 130 meters, and that you can really get a good amount of time. You can get like, you know, 30 minutes, that kind of thing, but you can be more specific, yeah. So usually when I do transects down to 130 meters, and I don't want to be down there any longer than, well, I do, but my body doesn't want to be down there any longer than 20 minutes. Yes. Right. Okay. Well, there's this is again. It's a really evolving subject area, and I find it really fascinating. And the actual markers that can tell us, hopefully, relationships between the different species, but also how they're actually responding to life. It's two kind of slightly different avenues of research. And so the markers in themselves can be problematic. So we're often, as we're trying to sample the material and run the genetic analysis, we often are dealing with markers that might not be fully reliable. So we're still trying to work out which ones are. So often the data that we provide, and we think these are the conclusions and these are how these are related, somewhere down the line we then discover that we need different markers. So, but it's actually with the dawn of genomics, we're actually finding out some very, very interesting information. So yes, I do use that. I get like it gives you like a fine-tuned structure to see how things have evolved over time, and then you can use computational analysis to actually track back to see, we call it coalescence, and track that back over to see how things have diverged at various points in time, and see if that's been related to, say, like the mass extinction events and things like that. But the other stuff that I find really fascinating is like what they're expressing right here, right now. You know, like what are we expressing right now to be breathing in and out? I want to know what they're expressing right here, right now, in order to be able to deal with the food that they're taking in, that kind of stuff, and the flow that they're in and that kind of thing. Because then, again, if I can use coalescence back on that, you can see how different traits for the different creatures, the different gorgonians, have actually come into play because they're being frequently used over time. Does that answer your question? All right, I can't go on. Yes? Mm-hmm. Mostly. Well, they do have a slightly different ratio in most cases, but it seems the evidence is currently suggesting that they actually survive very well, far, far better than their scleractinian counterparts. And they, of course, they're older in the geological record. They've been around a lot more. And they're like most recent common ancestors are actually a lot of them before the Permian extinction, mass extinction. So it shows that some of them are very, very robust. And this ongoing research, again, that was part of the research that I wanted to do in Aquaria, to actually assess what they're expressing and what makes them so biologically successful. What are they, you know, something's buffering their success, and what is that? Yes?
Yes, sorry. So from what you've shown, they can live in the shallower.
Yes.
Right. So what makes them live down, like the larvae, is the larvae not going off, or how do they reproduce? Or
so
in the world that they have larvae and...
Oh, right, okay, yeah. So they have a very wide distribution, basically. I mean, you can get gorgonians really up in the shallows. You can even get them in the mangroves, would you believe, all the way down to the abyssal plains. I mean, they really do. Their larval, they pretty much do the vast majority of reproductive strategies. So some of them can be broadcast spawners and can travel quite considerable distances. Most of them are brooders. And so you have a population specificity. So that's a really good question. So I think that's also, it is actually largely towards their biodiversity. Their larvae don't actually travel so far. But so most of them have a dual reproductive strategy. So they asexually fragment, they are vegetative, but also they are gonochoristic, so they'll also reproduce sexually. And as I say, different species do different things.
Right. So, the question is so those larvae, why would they settle in that metropolitan instead of in the shallow? Is there something there that makes them?
That's a very good question.
Or is it competition? Or?
Yeah, that's another ongoing research. I mean, how passive are they to their environment? How selective are they actually being? And you've got the crustose coralline algae, which penetrates quite deep, you know, especially in the twilight zone. And as we know, it's very successful for the scleractinia, and there's some evidence to suggest that's also the same for gorgonians and other species too. It's not just the cnidarians. So there's that chemotaxis, definitely, and also to their conspecifics, so their other species. And flow as well. So there's all these different biological, all these different physical environmental parameters that influence their ability to travel, but then also their ability to settle and survive. So settling is one thing, being able to survive is completely a different issue. Yeah. Yeah. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, hello.
I'm familiar with being able to take certain tissue samples and figure out what they need.
Yes.
Oh,
I'm working on it right now. It's really exciting. For me. Right, well, I mean, the first time I started actually doing that, I did stable isotopes on a zooxanthellate species. And I did it in different environments, which was one a heavily anthropogenically impacted environment and another one in what one would call a very healthy environment. And the one in the anthropogenically impacted environment had a lot of human effluent in that. And the signature came out that the corals were basically, and their zooxanthellae were actually eating the human effluent. So, you know, and so it's there. They're very responsive to their environment. They seem to be quite plastic. What I'm doing right now is I'm actually setting up. So we've got the experiments in aquaria and doing lots of behavioural observations and quantifying that. We're starting to set up some work with some colleagues of mine over in California doing tracer analyses. So using isotopic tracers to see how they actually travel through the coral. And the other thing which I find extremely fascinating is the expression profiles, seeing how they're responding to different feeds and that kind of thing. And then compare that with the same sort of samples, you know, the samples in situ, see what they're expressing there, and the samples from what we're doing in aquaria, and seeing, you know, how we can match, you know, how we can bring the aquaria up to sort of meet that as best as possible. Is that? Oh yeah. Oh goodness, yeah. We call them in the UK, we call it merle. Here you call it like rhodoliths. And yeah, absolutely. Heather Spaulding, good God, she's done some really good work on that. And there's loads of them off Kiana Point down deep. Yeah, 100 meters plus. Yeah, and we see a lot of it down there. Yeah. Yes?
Do you see any symbiotic predator prey type of relationships or interactions with fish and invertebrates or animals down there?
Yes, yes. The fish like to lay their eggs on some of the gorgonians. They certainly enjoy that. To be honest with you, we're not really down long enough to do behavioural observations. But I can say when I'm out on the atolls, it just brought a memory to me. I was trying to do the sampling, and there were so many blooming fish and sharks. They were actually a pain in the ass. Excuse my friend. I was trying to take a picture, and they were just kind of swimming in front of my lights. I was like, I know you're awesome, but get out of the way. I'm not here very long. I'm sure there is. I've got no evidence to back that up, other than like, wow, what are they doing? And you've always got loads of associates attached to the invertebrates, just loads of it. Steve?
You might mention about snails.
Yes, 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 you get these snails on there. Yeah, you definitely get predatory snails that like to eat polyps. And yes. Yeah, and those are the ones where the polyps, that's something else. So you get crustaceans that some of the crabs, the decorated crabs that stick the polyps on their back. Yeah, thank you, that's awesome. Yeah. Yes?
If you can only stay down for half an hour, how often can you go, when you have to go back up, when can you next go back down for another half an hour?
Tomorrow. Yeah, it depends on what our objectives are, and usually I like to get as much diving in as humanly possible. So yeah, tomorrow, really, the next day. We don't want to do it like you can't really. It's impossible. I mean, you can't just sort of come up again and then go down again. I mean, you could, what would be a bit, but it wouldn't be wise physiologically. And also, there's a tremendous amount of work to do, and the equipment. What would be wonderful is to have your own kind of like deep habitat, you know, saturation diving, and you can just sort of go out there, do your research, go back in, you know, process your specimens, and then go back out there and continue to work. Now, that would be amazing. but we haven't got there yet. But it doesn't mean it's out of the question. So, yeah, we are limited. So what we are doing, you know, I mean, you've got to be like, really like that all the time, and really I'm tremendously privileged to be diving with people like Rich and Brian that have been diving just as long as I have, and so we've got it's taken me many years, most of my life, to actually realize I always knew I was extremely fortunate in that sense, but how fortunate it is to actually be able to have these experiences, have these skills, but also now being able to do something what I feel deeply meaningful with, and also being able to help communities. And that was more than I could have asked for, really. It's like science meets policy. You know, the local communities, all we do is share what we do, and they sit down and they want to say, look, can you help us? And I'm like, sure, you know. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes.
So I understood that they don't really eat what you think they eat, so it suggests that they have a bacterial symbiome, I guess. When you did all your sampling and during your all your analyses, was there anything that stood out that could be like a potential or like several species of like symbionts or bacteria that could provide food to those gorgonians?
Yes, that's part of my hypothesis. I believe they're gardening.
But you have no candidates yet.
We're working on it. We do, but we don't as well. Yeah, we do and we don't. But yeah, some species so far seem to be quite species specific. But again, this is an ongoing concern. I mean, some of them like bioluminesce, and I'm like, oh my god, have we got Vibrio? What's going on? Have they got, you know, they're doing like the bobtail squid, you know, spit them out after an hour or so, you know, they reach that capacity. There's so much we just don't know. You know, I used to be terribly embarrassed. People would ask all these questions, and I'm like, oh, I'm sorry, I'm such a bad scientist, I don't know. But that's because we've not been there, so we don't know. Anyway, so. So I think that's it. Oh, we've got one more. Well, you can ask me afterwards.
Thank you so much, Sonia. Dr. Sonia Rowley. We really appreciate it. And please mark your calendars for April 6th, which will be our next event. And we will provide more details later. Stay tuned and visit our website for more opportunities and events coming up. Thank you all for coming and have a great evening. Thanks again, Dr. Rowley.